I'm actually trying to finish my PhD now, which is related with plant functional ecology related to land degradation and also to desertification. But today I will be talking about these experiments we made some years ago in Cecil, which is related to pine thinning. I will explain to you during the presentation why we did that. So, as Grass already talked about, ecological restoration can be described as the process of assisting the recovery of the ecosystem. And when we're talking about ecological restoration, we are talking about recovering not only the structure and the diversity of the ecosystem, but also the functioning. And according to SER, which is Restoration Ecology Society. The restored ecosystem must have other attributes. I believe Teresa mentioned them already. But I would like to emphasize this presence of functional groups and also the self-sustainability and the resilience to further disturbance. That would be important. So, we want to do that, but which are the main constraints to achieve these type of goals? Well, I just put here some of them. I'm sorry, I'm not dominating this because the pointers in a different way. So I just put it here some constraints because I want to highlight. Well, sometimes we have the introduction of fast growing species. Sorry, the fast growing species. And quite often we have undesired or unpredictable outcomes, and so we need the monitoring, as we told before, to see what is happening and to see whether we have to do something about it. And the main challenges, I believe, in ecological restoration today are linked with this recovery of the ecosystem as a whole, with this ecosystem functioning, and some links also with the provision of ecosystem services to people, and also to try to integrate in restoration the resilience to climate change projections. So, but when we face these undesired or unpredicted outcomes, as Adelaide mentioned before, we design the seeding, for instance, how can we deal with that? So, we can use this adaptive management, which very briefly is to try to have in a flexible manner, deal with these unexpected results by making adjustments in management decisions. So we have a certain problem, a certain degradation problem, we assess that, we design a form of recovering that, we implement that strategy, then we monitor, we evaluate, and if necessary, we adjust that and start this loop again. So it is combining research with active management, and then we have this adaptive management. So I'm going to talk to you, to show you an experiment we made, where we wanted to solve a problem we had with our restoration results. So restoration in Cecil, as has been told before as well, is done with several species, with plantations here in these terraces, which form a kind of chronal sequence with different ages. And several species have been planted in these terraces. You can see here the list. So most of them are native, which is a very good thing, but some of them are not very frequent in the surroundings. And one of them, which was used in a considerable density, was this level pine, Pinus lupensis. Well, I believe most of you have been already heard about this species because it has been widely used in restoration, mainly in the Mediterranean basin. Probably some of you have seen restoration with this species in your countries. But the problem is that this species frequently creates a community with low diversity and also high vulnerability, for instance, to short fire intervals or to pests. So it is becoming a problem. And in the quarries, not only here in the quarry, but along the Mediterranean basin, because people want to know how to deal with that, how to change these low diversity pine stands into more diverse and more resilient ecosystems. In the quarry, in those platforms I told you about, you can see here that it dominates. You will see tomorrow the groups that will go to the platforms. It became dominant in height and in cover as well. And it is responsible for the main differences we found in comparison with the natural vegetation of the park. So our hypothesis is that it was competing with the other species, which are mostly sclerophyllous Mediterranean species with slow growth rates, and this pine is fast growing. So we hypothesized that it was competing with them, and we have to take into consideration that these restored sites have limitations in terms of soil quality, in terms of nutrients, for instance. And so we hypothesized that it could be injuring the incoming of spontaneous species from the natural surroundings due to canopy closure as well. So. Our question was that if a pine thinning would enhance biodiversity in these platforms. So we did a pine thinning experiment. We did that on two platforms. One of them was by that time 15 years old, and the other was 10 years old. This is the 10 years old, and the 15 years old goes on. So you can see here a thing and the control plot. We did a We thinned about 40% of pine cover. You can see here the three dimensions by the time. And so initially the density was similar in the control and the thin plots. And by the end, we removed this density in the older platform and this 36% density in the younger platform. This is the experimental design. You will see tomorrow better. There's no point in going into detail with that, but the platforms are more or less this shape. So we need several blocks to control the heterogeneity along the platforms and the component seed pots with several replicates. And it is important to mention that we did this, and then we evaluated the plant community before the thinning, in the following year, and in the next two years after the thinning. And we didn't only look at the plant community regarding its taxonomic composition, the species that were there, but we also were interested in species' functional role in the ecosystem. So we chose some functional traits, like draw strategy, because we're talking about a place that is a dry land. It has a dry subhumid climate. It's not semi-arid, but it's dry subhumid. So it is important, this draw strategy, to cope with drought. The life form, we found it was also important because it's also related to drought adaptation, but also with nutrient cycling, with the higher or lower turnover of leaves, for instance. And visibility, as we all know, it is very important to improve soil quality, and also the dispersal, because we are expecting that species from natural surroundings colonize those areas more and more. So, what did we get with this experiment? You can see here the results in terms of richness, species richness. We found no effect of thinning. We were quite discouraged at the beginning because we found no effect on species overall diversity, looking at species. Not even when we separated them according to different functional groups. But we found several differences in composition. For instance, here you can see an increase. This is the thinned treatment. And this is the control treatment. So you see here a significant increase in spontaneous shrubs density. This is the density. In response to thinning, you see here the first year where thinning was applied, and then the first year and the second year after thinning. And this increase in spontaneous shrubs was actually the responsible group for that were these semi-deciduous species. which are represented here by the SNSD, you see here, these ones, and also a little bit these ones, which are the green steamed species. This is according to the functional groups I told you before. So there was an increase in this group of species, which have a very high drought tolerance, so it is important. Higher rates of carbon fixation, because these species are those sister species that Adelaide told you before. They take advantage of any rain event to grow very rapidly. So they have this opportunistic kind of strategy. And it may be very important. And another aspect is that they shed, they are semi deciduous, so they shed a good part of their leaves, and that may contribute to improve soil in a medium to long term. So, these may be advantage under climate change scenarios of rainfall, altered rainfall distribution, extreme events. So these species, they are important there, and the increase in extensity may be important to the resilience of these ecosystems. And these green steamed leaves, these species are able to fix nitrogen, they are leguminous species, so it is a good thing also that they increase in response to seeding. Then we saw that herbaceous species also increase a lot. So I hope you have clear now that there were only woody species which were introduced there. They were planted there, but no herbaceous species were actively put there. So they are the result of the spontaneous colonization. And after thinning, they also increased significantly. And mainly animal species. So, and we found it is important for litter turnover because these sclerophyll species tend to immobilize nutrients, while these animal species die every summer, and so they contribute to soil formation. So, they are also important. And also herbaceous and fixing species. We saw an increase in leguminous animal species as well in response to seeding. Concerning the dispersal strategy, so we saw an increase in animal species, which are represented here by the A. You see here an increase, but also in the baroqueous species that are dispersed by gravity, so seeds lie on the ground, and also ectoswalkers, which, for instance, they include ant dispersion, you know what I mean. We found the increase in species with this kind of dispersal, which is also a good sign. And we didn't find no effect on the endozoophorous species, which are the ones that need, for instance, small mammals or birds to disperse. And that may be due to perhaps a lower abundance of these factors, of these dispersers in the periterraces. And also, as the exploitation is still going on, it causes also a bit of disturbance, and perhaps so the thing had no effect on that. And we saw also a positive effect of thinning on the growth of the co-planted evergreen sclerophylls. We have here increase in the in this case in the basal area. And also a slight increase in growth of semi-deciduous shrubs. So this is the evidence of the competitive relief, either because of canopy the removal of the canopy, so increased light, and also water, because of course water is a limitation in this ecosystem. So in the end, we concluded that although pine thinning had no effect on overall diversity in terms of species number, it was quite important because it promoted the incoming of species with end-fixing ability, the increase in animal species, which may be important to contribute to soil formation, and also because thinning promoted a higher growth of the co-planted species. So it is actually competing with them. Pine thinning proved to be important to increase nutrient cycling and soil improvement, and also biotic fluxes to that dispersion and ecosystem resilience in these highly degraded areas. And as I told you, because a label pine and other pines as well are very much used in restoration, this is an important information not only for Cecil, but also for researchers and managers in Mediterranean Basin and in other parts of the world dealing with this problem of low diversity pine dominated areas, trying to make them more diverse and more resilient. So, and that's all for now. Thank you very much.